schedule and time.
Are we gonna start with a particular one?
No, I'm going to start with the first one, which is there's probably one. We'll open the prayer, and then I'll do a couple of hours, maybe like a question to the whole city.
Okay.
Just keep things up, and we'll get quite a few.
Gotcha. So,
and,
okay.
But basically, song over prayer, songs.
Well, we're going to do something a little bit different tonight. Okay, it's going to be a lot of bit different. Not just a little bit, a lot of bit different. So we're going to have a song, then we'll open in prayer. But after we open in prayer, we're going to take some requests for a song you all might want to sing. So if you have a song in mind, make sure you tell me the page number, the name of the song, and if we know it, we'll do it. If I don't know it, I'll tell Brother Gary to do it. No, I'm just kidding. Because he knows more songs than I do, apparently. At least that's what he tells me. So anyway, no, not really. But either way, we'll between the two of us, we should know a good many of them. So we'll have a good time tonight. Just, whoa, dude, that got loud. Thank you, Kyle. I appreciate that. All right. So let's go ahead and open up with hymn number 45. Hymn number 45. We're just going to do the first and last verse of this one. And then we'll open in prayer afterwards. But we want to get a couple songs in tonight, so go ahead and stand. We will do the first and last verses of There Is Power in the Blood. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Or evil, a victory win. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the... Last verse now. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Amen. Well, let's go ahead and open up in a word of prayer, and then we'll do some more singing right afterwards. Brother Scott, why don't you open us up, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for this day. Thank you for everybody being able to come and serve you. I just thank you for the message this morning. And just thank you for this time that we're able to celebrate our graduates, Lord.
Amen.
We have everybody getting ready for camp, to go to camp. The ones that will be driving up there, the teams that will be going more, I feel like you just
Amen. All right. Who's got Miss Linda? See your hand first.
Yeah,
oh. Well, she wins the prize then. All right. 108. Hide Thou Me. Do I know this one? You know, I've only heard quartet versions of this song. I wonder if it's any different than this version. I don't know. Brother Gary, could you help us out just to be sure? I don't want to make sure. Do you know this one? All right. You know, between the two of us, we'll have a good time tonight. All right, brother.
If you want to, you can stay over here with me.
My lot comes Okay, we're going to do just one verse of another song, okay?
113,
oh, that's a good one. Are you going to help us lead this one too?
I can.
All right, 113. We'll do just the first verse of Blessed Assurance, 113.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Do announcements, but we're going to come back and do some more, so be ready.
Well, it is good to have you here at Bible Baptist Church. For those of you that don't know, and I'm doing this for the sake of the men in this church, that we might build a little bit of an attitude of protecting our gentlemen, our men. We went to a activity last night or yesterday at Jacksboro at the state park up there with Brother Ken Brinson's class. Thank them for inviting us to go, and we went. They tried to kill us by making me walk 400 miles, but still, I left early, and I wasn't there. If I'd have been there, I would have stopped it. But I understand you had a softball game or a baseball game or a woofie ball game or something. And I understand that we have a lady in our church that was trying to run to second and was hitting a man with a ball bat. That would be Kate. Amen. She attacked one of our gentlemen. I think that's grounds for being brought before a discipline committee. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we're not listening. You can't talk. Anyway, we did have a really great time, and we appreciate the young adult class letting us go with them and the fun we had and all the food. Man, we had food galore, but it was a little bit strenuous and wore me plumb out. I'll tell you, it don't take you long to know how old you are. You start hanging around with young married people. Amen. Amen. Anyway, before we get into the announcements any at all, I want to back up and take care of some business from this morning. This morning, we were able to recognize two of our graduating seniors, Miss McKenzie and Miss Brother Austin, but Miss Bailey wasn't here. So we don't want her to go away not recognized and get... You have a box outside, by the way, that's got, well, I don't know if there's anything in it or not. Depends on if anybody likes you or not. I don't think he put nothing in it. Come up here, Bailey. We send all of our seniors out with a Bible in their hands.
Amen.
Youth camp, last time at all today. After this, all you're going to see in there that we're leaving June the 20th, the afternoon of Father's Day, and going off to the Colorado Mountains. We're going to stay there a week and enjoy some good preaching and some young people. And I'm telling you, they have, for camp food, they have good food.
Amen.
But it is young people's food. It's all starch.
New cook this year.
And it's just, we got a new cook?
Kenny retired.
Kenny, oh my goodness. Wow. Have you got any reports on the food?
From what I'm told, it's a member of First Baptist Englewood, and they're going to try to keep the exact same menu.
Oh. Who?
Deb.
Oh, yeah. She's the cook?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, it won't change then. Amen. Anyway, the camp is awesome, and for some of you adults that haven't ever had a chance to go, you ought to consider taking a little vacation next year and getting on board with our teenagers and going to the Colorado Mountains. You don't have to. We have like four rooms reserved up there, and you don't have to stay in the dorms with the kids. Thank God. Amen. You can go and sit back and enjoy the camp. The food is pretty good, but the best part is they have awesome concession stands.
Yes, they do.
After you've eaten all day, you can go out there and you can get french fries and funnel cakes and ice cream and popcorn and all kinds of stuff.
Park there for a while.
Huh? Yeah, buddy, I'm telling you. So consider that for next year, if you would. Some of you adults that have never been to the mountains of Colorado, amen. It's worth going to. It's a great camp, amen. So anyway, that's going on. Then also, church-wide fish fry this Saturday, July the 3rd. It's coming up here in a while. We get back from camp. And we're going to begin the cooking. Somebody asked me this morning, Brother Gentry asked me this morning, he said, who do I have to see to get involved with the cooking? I said, show up. Show up. You know, you couldn't run him off with a stick. Amen. Because if you don't know this, gentlemen, let me tell you about this cooking stuff. Whoever does the cooking gets to sample the fish. We get it coming right out of the grill. The hush puppies are hot. You got to blow on them to hold them in your hand. Amen. By the time we come in to have the food in the fellowship hall, all the cooks are sitting outside saying, well, I'm done.
Be careful, preacher. There'll be a line there.
Well, if they all come, we'll start this cooking thing early. Amen. We said around 12, but anyway, we're going to be doing that. That's all I've got for tonight. I'll get to visiting. I'll
Amen.
All right, let's see here. Who's got another one? Miss Callie. 31. I believe that's Hide Down. No. That is He Hideth My Soul. I knew the Hide was in there somewhere. Let's do just the first verse, and then we will go from there. So please stand with me. We will do just the first verse of 31. He Hideth My Soul. Farther along, okay? All right.
That's a song about getting older, isn't it?
Man, it's been a long time since I've heard this one. That's a good one.
I thought you wanted 257. Okay.
That was one of the original ones I chose, I think. Nope, it wasn't. Right. 230 further along. First verse on it.
'Tempted and tried, we're all made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long, while there are others living about us, never molested, knowing the wrong. Farther along, we'll know all about it. Farther along, we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by.
We're going to do two more. You know what? We'll do two more. Miss Monette, 229. This world is ahead. We're right there. All right. Good deal. 229, we're already there.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
All right, Kyson.
25.
Well, okay, the choir's going to sing this in 2 weeks, so this will be practice, so you all can join in the choir. How about that? 25, Glorious Freedom, and ushers, if you will, please come on the chorus. No, we're not going to do a solo on this. Just first verse, and then we'll go from there.
Once I was bound by sin's calling fetter, chained like a slave, I struggled in vain. But I received a glorious freedom when Jesus broke my fetters in twain.
Praise the Lord for the good singing tonight. Thank you for the participation in it. Brother David, would you pray for the offering, please?
Father, we thank you for the night, Lord. We thank you for all these wonderful songs, Father. We just ask you to bless this offering. Bless the message we're going to get tonight, Father. Father, I just want these seniors that are graduating, I just want you to go with them and bless them. And they're just starting their life.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, man. Be seated. Thanks for giving us.
Well, amen. So good to have you here this evening. We appreciate you coming out on this so far dry evening. They telling me that that's going to change here after a while, but I was looking at my phone and it said in this area it was supposed to be raining right now. And as best I can tell, the sun's still shining. We had started a series of lessons and are just getting into it pretty well out of the book of Proverbs that is our kind of a stepping stone to give us our direction. And the Bible tells us in Proverbs chapter 16, verses 17, the highway of the upright is to depart from evil. He that keepeth his way preserveth his soul. From the day that we get saved, we start out on an adventure. We start out on a whole different life than we've ever lived before as we walk in the paths of righteousness, as we walk in the fellowship with God, for how can two walk together except they be agreed? And we were discerning that it's a little bit of a different walk or life than we might have expected. I remember when they were talking to me about finding Christ as my Savior, how free it was and how much God loved me and how simple it was just to repent of my sins and ask God to save me. What they didn't tell me was what came next. Amen? And so that from the time that you meet Christ, we begin this walk of a new a pathway, and it leads or leads us to the very dwelling place of God in eternal life. One day we will be where God is. But we do know, and this is where we had been in the lesson from last week, we do know that we are in a battle. The moment that you get saved, you've taken sides, or God's side, against the wickedness of the world, and you have a real enemy in this world. Satan's real. He's not a fable. He's real, and he hates you because he hates Jesus. He wants to accuse you in heaven. He wants you to fall so he can have accusation against the very blood of Christ. Amen? So he is your enemy. We found out also that the world doesn't like you. Amen. The world is tainted because of sin. The world walks after the way of lust that men do encourage it in or encourage men in. And then we found that you're your worst enemy. Amen. We're saved and want to do right, but Paul said, those things I would do, I don't. Those things I don't do, guess what? Those are the ones that trip me up so often and that I do. Amen. And so we are in this war, and we had gone back to the book of Deuteronomy for our lesson. Yes, in Deuteronomy, the Bible tells us, or the Lord tells us, that He's going to instruct Israel in how to go out, go about war. Amen? I know that for those of us, we celebrated Memorial Day here not too long ago, and for a lot of us, we were in the military, and one of the things that the military does is it trains you in how to go to war. It tells you what you have to do. It tells you how to, let me tell you, you need to be in shape. Tells you how to, teaches you how to use your instrument. So many believers don't know how to wield the sword that they hold in their hand. We need to be trained. And God's going to give instructions in Deuteronomy to how to go to war. And those instructions on a physical basis apply spiritually as well. Amen. And so we're going to read just a couple of verses in Deuteronomy. Chapter 20, if you would. Stand with me. Underline these first words because they're going to be very relevant to the rest of our message tonight. When thou goest out to the battle against thine enemies. Amen? When thou goest out to the battle against thine enemies and seest horses and chariots and a people more than thou, be not afraid of them. Can I tell you, when you're in a war, there's always fear to deal with. Because it's a real thing. It's a hazardous thing. It says, be not afraid of them, for the Lord thy God is with thee, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And it shall be when you are come nigh unto the battle that the priest shall approach and speak unto the people and shall say unto them, hear, O Israel, ye approach this day unto the battle against your enemy. Let not your hearts faint. Fear not. And do not tremble, neither be ye terrified because of them. For the Lord your God is He that goeth with you to fight for you against your enemies to save you. You may be seated. You recall we've already talked about this Christian warfare and how that we have to be understand the enemy that we're fighting against, and we have to be committed to the battle. We're not to entangle ourselves with the things of the world, but first and foremost in our mind is to be the battle of righteousness that we fight in a wicked world, that the whole world might have a glorified Savior, Jesus Christ, set before them through our life and through our witness in our walk. Let your conversation be that which glorifieth the Father. Amen. And so that we have found that to be understood. Amen. We found that we have a great captain. Our captain has promised us the victory. But I'm telling you, even when the victory is promised, the battle will be fierce. Because the enemy doesn't believe you've got the victory. I promise I have read the end book, the end chapter of this Bible. I've read Revelation. I've read where the devil's going to be taken and cast into the pit forever and ever, where the false prophet and the Antichrist are. I've read that. I've read where God's going to take the devil and chain him for 1,000 years. I've read that. I know we have the victory. You think the devil believes it? Can I tell you how much the devil don't believe it? When he's loosed from hell, he's going to go raise an army out of the world of that day and then that time and attack the very throne of God.
Amen.
Amen. So we understand that we have a victory. But can I tell you, it does not matter what kind of a captain you have. Does not matter who is the head of the army or of your military forces. It's all about the boots on the ground. The soldiers that's going to fight the army or fight the war. We have a general, we have a captain that goes into that war with us. He doesn't sit in the background, he goes into the war with us. But he tells us that we are to be warriors for the glory of God. We're to be soldiers in his army, amen? But what I want to talk about tonight, and I'm going to try to finish this message tonight.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Gary. I want to talk to you about the unfitness for the battle. Now here's the word I wanted you to remember. When thou goest out to the battle against thine enemies. We are a blessed nation. For the most part, all of the wars that we've fought against other nations, not counting of course the civil war that we fought within our own frame or within our own ranks. But when we have fought wars, but we've always gone out to the battle. We've never fought them on our own soil. We didn't fight Germany here. We didn't fight Japan here other than the sneak attack in Pearl Harbor. We took the battle to them.
Amen.
Amen. So when you go out to the battle, when you're raising an army, when Israel had an enemy come and array themselves in the valley, they would send the message out to all the tribes of Israel, send us an army. And each tribe would gather the men of age of war, and they would bring that army together, and they'd go down into the valley, and they'd go out to the valley and fight the war. Amen?
Amen.
And God's going to set some qualifications for the war. It's an amazing thing what we find here, because we didn't even read that part of the verse. But if you'll read with me in verses 5 in Deuteronomy, what an interesting verse this is. He says, the Lord's going to fight for you and against the enemies to save you, verse 4, and the officers shall speak unto the people, saying. Now he's speaking to the men that have come up to be counted to be in the army. He's speaking to them who are going out to the conflict. And he says, the captain, the officers shall speak unto the people, saying, what man is there that hath built a house and hath not dedicated it? Let him go and return to his house, lest he die in the battle, and another man dedicate it. And verse 6, and what man is he that hath planted a vineyard and hath not eaten of it? Let him also go and return to his house, lest he die in the battle, and another man eat it. And what man is there that hath betrothed the wife and hath not taken her? Let him go and return to his house, lest he die in the battle, and another man take her. Now he says this, everybody shouldn't go to the battle.
Amen?
Amen? And can I tell you, these are exceptions to go to the battle that are worth taking note of. Israel was a nation of great tradition. And I looked and looked and looked, and I found nothing in the scripture to validate the fact that if a man built a house, he was supposed to go dedicate it before he went to war. But it was a tradition in Israel that, legitimately speaking, that if you were going, or the nation was going into combat, and you had just built a house, you were free from that battle to go and tend to your house, set it in order, get things arranged, so that that house becomes a memorial to the name of your father and to your children who will be raised in that home. It was a traditional accepted practice. Okay? Not a bad thing. And then he says this in verse 6, and if you plant a vineyard and haven't eaten it, Now, we're talking about every man, every woman, every person in Jerusalem or in Israel understood these rules of war. They didn't seek to not go to the battle, but they were excused from this particular combat if these things applied. And it says here, if you had a vineyard and you've never drank of the wine, never eat of any of the fruit from it, that you have a right to not go to war. Amen? And if you go all the way back over, and we're not going to, but the Old Testament gives authenticity to that and tells us the same thing all the way back. Leviticus. In the book of Leviticus, it talks about how that if you've got a vineyard, that you have the right to eat of that vineyard and not to be swayed to do any other thing until that's been accomplished. So that was actually part of the law. And then he says, if you have a wife. Now know this, folks. It's extremely important, scripturally speaking, in the nation of Israel to keep your lineage alive, that your name not be removed out from amongst Israel. And when you married a wife, the most important, and by the way, what they're talking about here, if a man hath married a wife and has not established that home yet, he's talking about that betrothal period when the man and the woman would be given one to another and they're betrothed and they're looking for that time when the bridegroom will come and get the bride and they'll establish the home. And they're saying it's important for that man to keep alive the heritage of his father's name in the land. So if he's taken a wife and hath not yet married or consummated that wedding, that he's to do that before anything else, lest his father's name be blotted out of Israel. For if he goes out to the battle and gets killed, someone else will raise up seed with that woman unto their father's heritage. That make sense? So these are legitimate things. Amen. But if you go over to the book of Luke, chapter 14, and I want you to do that. Luke chapter 14 and verse 16. And I want you to see how those things that are legitimate can become illegitimate. Listen to what this says. Now this is the story of a certain man who made a great supper and bed many. You know the story. Listen to what he says. Verse 17, and sent his servant and at supper time and said to them that were bed, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. Listen to the excuses. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground and must needs go and see it, and I pray thee to excuse me. And another said, I bought a 5 yoke of oxen and go to prove them, and I pray you excuse me. And another said, I've married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. Please excuse. Does this sound familiar? That which was legitimate, that no warrior in the nation of Israel would think one thing bad about you for any one of these things, that the captains went to the people and said, if this is your situation, step forward and go home and care for your business. If you made a commitment of marriage, go fulfill that commitment. If you are have a home, then establish that home. These were legitimacy. Now they've become illegitimate. Because God now is calling His people to the great supper, and they are with all accord making an excuse. This is Israel when Jesus comes into the world and says, I am He. I am that one which the Father hath sent. And with one, and He says, come unto me. And then with one accord, they make an excuse, ended up crucifying Him. So these here are not going to the battle. They are not to go to the battle. But they are not treasonous in their attitudes. They are not, what do we call it? Patriot. It's not patriotic for them. Amen? That's kind of interesting, isn't it? You remember that God Himself is the one that establishes the armies of Israel. In fact, David sinned against God mightily as the greatest king I believe Israel ever had, Solomon the wisest, but David surely was him that spread the borders of Israel. He was the one that went out and fought the battles even when Saul was king. It was all about David. Amen? And the kings of Israel were not even by the rule of God allowed to number how many people there were in Israel, how many warriors and all that. They weren't allowed to do that. David did it. And God cursed Israel. You remember the story of the threshing floor of Aruna, where he goes up and makes a sacrifice and an offering, and God says, I'm going to give you a choice. Don't you hate it when you get choices? Choices that aren't good any way you look at it. I'm going to cut off one finger on your left hand or two on your right. What choice is that? And God gives David choices, and he says, you want to fall into the hands of your enemy? David says, no, that don't sound good. He says, do you want to endure a pestilence or a harshness that'll come upon you? And David said, that doesn't sound good either. And then David used his head. He said, we have a great and merciful God. I would prefer to fall into the hands of someone that loves me and let him correct me based on his love. And he made a sacrifice and stayed that judgment of God. I thought that was awesome. I thought, David, you big dummy, why did you do that? You know why? Pride. Amen. So God is the one who ordains the armies. You remember the army of Gideon, how Gideon goes down with thousands, and by the time he gets to the war, he's got 300. Amen. And God's going to thin out the people. And some of those that he sends home, can I tell you, as he sends them home, one of the things, the last thing, where he comes all the way down to 300, has absolutely nothing to do with bravery or warfare or a desire to go out and represent the nation, but it has to do with how you drink water out of the brook. If you bent over and you, he said, it's your home. You had to lap it with a dog. Be aware and alert. Be a warrior at heart. Amen. So God's established in the army, and God's going to give this leeway to the soldiers. Everybody is not required to go out to the battle. That's important. Keep it in mind. Go out to the battle. Amen. So there are some that are not qualified. We would, in our terminology, you young people don't know anything about this, there used to be a draft in this country. And if you'd go down to the draft, and during the military, during conflicts, I can recall back in my own time when we were going into, well, not Vietnam. Vietnam's a different situation. But there were always young men trying to get into the military to go off to war. But all of them, everybody that wanted to go fight and represent this nation didn't get in. We had what was called 4F. We talked about it a little bit last week. If you had flat feet, if you couldn't see, if you were in some way not a good specimen of a physical ability to be a soldier, you didn't get in. Amen? Didn't mean these people were cowards or unpatriotic. Just means they weren't qualified to go out to the battle. Amen? Because you want the best on the battleground. But I want to show you one more out of Deuteronomy, and then we'll move on to the rest of our message tonight. Look in verse 8. And the officer spake further unto the people, and they shall say, what man is there that is fearful and faint-hearted? Do you remember what Gideon, the first group of people Gideon sent home? Amen. Those that were fearful and faint-hearted. Let him go and return unto his house, lest his brother's heart faint as well as his heart. Now, do you understand somebody that goes into the battlefield that's fearful will get him and his brother killed? Amen? Amen. He has not the urgency of the conflict. He has the fear of his own well-being and not the concern for the well-being of the nation. And I can tell you, folks, if you've ever been around, if you're a soldier, fear is common. Fear is every soldier that's in conflict has fear in his heart. You just deal with it and go on and do what needs to be done. But there are those who are so fearful that they're of no good. You don't want somebody in a foxhole with you that's got his head buried down in the dirt, afraid he's about to get killed. He'll get you killed and him killed. So the first thing they do is says, if you're afraid, go home. Amen? So these are they which are not qualified to go to the battle. That make sense? Everybody is not a soldier for the battle. Amen? There has been days, do you also notice that when we call up an army, it used to be this way, and it was in Israel, nobody said, Miss Marty, you ought to get your gun and your uniform. Come on, join the army now. We didn't put women in the army, and we never put a woman in a combat situation. That's changing somewhat today, and I hate to see it. Because all of you dumb boys, and that's what you are, dumb boys. Yeah, amen. And that's what is in armies, folks. That's what wins wars, is young boys. Amen. From the ages of 18 to 30. That's who does the conflict. That's who does the battle. That's who we bury. I know this is not your case, but it's going to be for tonight because I got a grandson. This is his case. You met her in the army. She's a combat soldier, not a nurse, 10 miles behind the front line, combat soldier. You say, that's cool. We're in a battle together. Yeah, until she's taken prisoner and hung up in a tree somewhere over there where you can watch her scream and watch them torture. You know what he's going to do? He's going to go right over there where she's at and die with her. Everybody does not belong in a combat zone.
That's right.
Amen. Isn't that nice that we have rules? It's a blessing of God that we've never fought on this soil.
Amen.
We have a missionary to the Jews, and I've known several. Savolosky, if I got his right name correctly, I'll never forgive him. He's the one that did our services. I guess we were already legally married, though, weren't we? I was already dead in the water. He says this. Now, I've not been there, but this is just hearsay from him. That every Jewish person in Israel is in the army. Man, woman, young person. They're in the army. Because they're not going out to the battle, folks. They're living in the battle. They're surrounded by the enemy. There's no such thing as a 4F. You got flat feet, you're living with the enemy. You don't get the privilege of going home to dedicate a house because the enemy is all around that house you're dedicating. You don't get a privilege to go and spend time and raise up or establish your family in that marital relationship because the enemy will kill you and your wife. It's a different relationship. They don't go out to the battle, folks. They live in the battle. Can I tell you something? We're believers. We don't go out to the battle. We're living in the battle. We're living where Satan dwells. We're living where the world rules. We're living where my own flesh is enticed by my own weakness and lust. We're in the battle. There's no such thing as not being in the army. You're not a 4F. Nobody in God's army is 4F. Because we're not going out to the battle, folks. We're living in the battle.
Good. Amen.
Amen. I think that's why so often the Bible says, be not afraid. Amen. Because where does a man go that's fearful? Amen. It is the battle that we are involved with. We are not to be fearful and faint of heart because we need to have courage for this battle. When a battle comes, it's difficult. The enemy attacks, you attack, there's a conflict. And it's costly. It cost to be in the battle. In the nation we're living today, we preached this morning to you. You weren't here. I wish you'd have been, because I preached to you. We raise our children, but we don't teach them that they're in a battle. We teach them that they're living comfortably. And that they're preferred. And that they are better. We do, folks. And the first time when they get where you are and they walk away from that family identity, you know God set this up for the protection of children. The home is there for the protection of children.
Amen.
He put the father as the umbrella over the family. And the devil's got to go through the father before he can get to the children.
That's right.
You know why the prodigal son had such a hard time? Because he left the protection that God put in place in his daddy. And right under him, he did something even more great, I guess, fantastic. He put a wife, a mama. So there's an umbrella of a father, and right under that's the umbrella of the mother, and right under that the children dwell. And they are protected. The more holy and righteous you are, the more the devil cannot get to your kids. Because he's got to go through you. He's got to follow God's chain of command. Amen? He does. But when a child is in rebellion to his parents, which we have in our homes everywhere because we've encouraged it, we're destroying the protection of our children in the battle. And they wonder why our kids are going through such trauma and so much hardship. It's because we've not taught them they're in a battle. They're not going out to the war. They're in the war. Can I tell you how to defeat an army? I was in the army. I was blessed. I had a lot of older people in the military. I went in at 17 years old, got back out before I was 21. But I met some older guys. Now you understand, if they were in the army at 20, they were older at 40. They were ready for retirement at 40. So when I say older guys, I'm talking about, compared to most of you, young guys. But within where they were, they still had the ability to be involved and to go out to the war. Because they had experience and they were leaders and they could lead people and young men to take them out into conflict and combat and bring them back alive. But we've taught our children, don't worry about it, there's no war. We've done away with the draft, which I wouldn't like to see that come back. But spiritually speaking, don't you think it's about time we started teaching our children they're in the midst of a battle? Because we've lost a generation of young people. I was going to tell you how to destroy an army. Destroy the source of the soldier. Destroy the river that the water comes out of. We have lost a generation that don't know there's a battle. If the devil can get our kids, folks, who's going to fight? Who's going to win the battle? It's about these young people. I told you this morning, tomorrow, our tomorrows rest on them. And the devil is about destroying God's army. And he's doing so by allowing us who are believers to raise children in church, maybe see them saved as young people, but we're not teaching them that they're in a battle. There is a situation that happens to soldiers. I forgot what they just call it. Just went out of my head. Post, PTSD. What is it called?
PTSD.
Yes, PTSD. Post-traumatic stress syndrome. Yeah. It's a conflict or a battle. They used to call it at one time, they called it battle fatigue. And another place, if you watch Patton, they called it shell-shocked, to where someone who goes into a battle and is totally traumatized by what they see and encounter and do until they're not functionable. And someone who has PTSD or shell shock or whatever you want to call it is not a good soldier on the battlefield. You know why? Because he wasn't taught what to expect. He wasn't taught about the war and the cost of war. How many of you young people ever been to a funeral? Young people now. How old are you? 18. And you've not been to a funeral? Who else? Let me see. Young people, you have not been to a funeral. Oh, you've been. I know you have. Okay. How many of you older people have been to a funeral and walked by a coffin and heard somebody say, well, they look better now than they did when they were alive? Have you not? Or you walk up and say, man, they were pretty sick. They really made them look good. And we walk away saying, you know, this thing of the war and the battle and the death and all, it's not as serious as everybody talking about. Don't they look good? Come go with us sometime. We'll let you walk and stand by that bed when they die. We'll let you see what death really is. The devil wants us to beautify death so that the first time a young person encounters it, it causes them to go, ah! You better teach your kids about the battle because they're in it. They're not going out to a battle, they're in it. There is no 4F, there is no one that's allowed not to participate. We're all soldiers from this age up. Amen. And the battle is raging. Amen. Now, let's do one more thing and I'll be done. If we're all in the battle, because we're not going out to the battle, folks, we're living in the battle. Amen? Then we have to discern this. There are people who are not going to be a combat soldier even if we live in the presence of the enemy. Now, they may be forced into a position to be in that combat, but there are those who just aren't able. And hear me now. When we get older, our abilities lessen. There comes a time when we just cannot do what we once did. There are people who are believers that, in my opinion, are ladies and women in our churches that ought not to be carrying the load of the battle as the man is carrying it. Amen. We need masculine leadership in churches, not taking anything away from our ladies. A church can't function without our women. But I'm telling you, God puts up an umbrella which is a masculine authority and an umbrella which is the woman's authority, and the children gather under it. Amen. But every person that lives in the combat zone. I heard this once years ago, because now when we go to combat, when we go into a war zone, I've seen it with our politicians and since Vietnam, folks, that the idea is, well, we're going to go in and attack this area, so all you people that want to leave, go ahead and get out. And then we go into that zone and there's people, and we hear this in the war zone. Well, they're non-combatants. You know what that means is? They're not real soldiers. You can't shoot them. Can you tell me how you know the difference between a combatant and a non-combatant? Yeah. Yeah. If you're in a war zone where you're living in the war, everybody in the war zone is in the battle. Amen. We're not all going to be that combat soldier, but every one of us has to be involved in that battle. If you can't be that frontline soldier, then you ought to be a prayer warrior. Our ladies do so much in this church to make sure this church functions. Watch them. I'm telling you, we got the best bunch of working ladies you've ever seen. Amen. Amen? And God get the glory for it, because they're in the battle. Nobody sits on the sideline. If you sit on the sideline, you can't go home. There is no safe zone for a believer. They that would live godly shall suffer persecution, because as I told you this morning, the devil's marked you. He's put your picture on the post office wall and say the number one most wanted person, and that's you. Because you're not going out to the war, folks. The war is already where you are. So verse 1 of chapter 20 says, when thou goest out to the battle, well, put this down in your mind. You don't have to go anywhere. The battle's here. And the rules of being able to go home, the rules that allow you not to go into the conflict, don't apply to God's army. We do, however, one point, and I'm through. I told you that a second ago, didn't I? One point. God has a great retirement plan for the soldier. It's in Thessalonians chapter 4 when He calls us up to heaven. Amen? Then we shall walk. Remember that difference we talked last week about Ephesians chapter 6 and the combat uniform? When God calls His bride home, when He calls us out in Thessalonians, we're going to put on white robes, washed white in the blood. Amen. That's the dress uniform. And we're going to march and parade, and God's going to present His bride holy and spotless to the Father. But until that happens, you live in the battle. There is no safe zone. Listen to me, the devil doesn't see you, your wife, your grandmother, your son, your daughter, or your little children as non-combatants. He sees them all as the enemies that he's out to destroy. You're in a battle. Amen? As you walk the King's highway, it is not an easy walk. Jesus said, "Take up thy cross and follow me." Amen? Stand with me if you would. Heavenly Father, Lord God, as we come tonight, we thank you so much for your instructions in the Word of God, Lord, that allows us to know that it is an everyday thing. It's an all-day battle. It never ends. Even in the nighttime when we rest and sleep, the devil will attack us in our mind. Lord, I pray that you might help us to instruct our young people that this is a real thing, that the responsibility of being a soldier in the army of God is a real thing, and that we each one need to take it very seriously because the victory is given to us by the promise of God. But it's all about our being involved in the battle as we walk on that King's highway. Bless, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Page 40, we're going to sing a verse of invitation.